One of the fascinating aspects of the speech by Brigitte Gabriel last night while she was here in Twin Falls, that at least that got my attention, she was referencing two major events that happened in the last century that she believes led to this resurgence of Islamic radicalism around the world. Now, she didn't mention the creation of modern Israel. I might have thrown that one in there. And she didn't mention as well, perhaps, the division of the Middle East into states that were just pretty much drawn willy-nilly on a map and then put into place. But she talked a little bit about one of those events being what happened in Iran in 1979 when the Ayatollah Khomeini took over the country and changed the government and its approach. And that was a huge event in my lifetime because of what followed the hostage taking. And we realized that these people do not work like the rest of the planet when it comes to their approach to government and diplomacy, politics, and that this is an entirely new ideology that we're up against. And they're going to call their own shots. And really, there's not much you can do about it, save, I guess, bombing their cities back into the Stone Age. Now, in other parts of the Islamic world, that might be an improvement. But in Iran, that might be the only way to ever bring them into line. And as I was listening to that, I was thinking about what transpired in the last few days with the news breaking in the Wall Street Journal about the ransom payments to the Iranians. And the White House is quibbling about this. It's now criticizing. Think about this. Back during the Watergate scandal, Ron Ziegler, the then press secretary, I met Ron before he died at a— he was giving a speech, and I got to chat with him about a book about his former boss, Richard Nixon, and he was not happy about the book. I remember that. But we had an opportunity to speak, but he used to come out and address the media, and he'd blame the Washington Post and mention that Ben Bradley was one of John Kennedy's old pals, and they were just simply out to get Nixon and the like. Well, President Obama is now making some claims like that about the Wall Street Journal. In other words, he's blaming those folks for looking into his dirty laundry. And Michael Mukasey, the former attorney general, said, look, they didn't do anything illegal. It is unethical. Now, a lot of this, though, is coming down to when actually that first $400 million payment was made in relation to the release of four American hostages who were being held in that country, including Pastor Saeed Abedini of Boise. And we've been told, well, look, there was no quid pro quo going on there. They were going to release these hostages anyway. That was a done deal. But as it turns out, it all took place on the same day. And now the State Department will not even answer reporters' questions about what happened first. Did the money get delivered and the hostages released, or did they get released and then the money arrived? Because that is a key in how this would work, right? It's 62. It's 10 minutes after 9 o'clock. Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310 KLIX and newsradio1310.com. Pastor Abedini appeared last night on the Fox Business Network. And he said, look, I think he has answered the question.
They told us, well, you're going to be there for 20 minutes, but it took like hours and hours. We slept at the airport, and when I asked them why you don't let us go, because the plane was there, pilot was there, everyone was ready that we leave the country, they said, we are waiting for another plane. He told me, we are waiting for another plane, and if that plane take off, then we're going to let you go.
In other words, we're waiting for the ransom payment. I think that answers our question, doesn't it? And Pastor Abedini has no reason to lie. You know, he's a man of God and went through a horrible experience and he was released. And I'm sure he was grateful to be released. And he was grateful to the Obama White House for finally getting that done. But in his telling of the story, they were held up while they waited for that plane load of loot to arrive. And once it got there, then they were told, you can go now. I think that the White House is being a little bit, how shall we put it, sullen, there's a petulant, that's the word, about what actually happened here. And they don't like the criticism because it shows that they've been duped by the Iranians once again, just like Jimmy Carter was on a daily basis when he was serving in the White House. A friend of mine he's retired as a sheriff's deputy from, I believe, Prince George's County in Maryland, and he used to tell me all the time, he says, Barack Obama is an Arabic word for Jimmy Carter. I tend to believe that that could be true after the way the Iranians have run circles around this man over the course of the last 7.5 years. It's coming up on 12 minutes after 9 o'clock. We have a caller with us. The number 736-0300. And you're up next. You're on the air with Bill Colley on Top Story.
Good morning, Bill. Bill, many years ago, swimming instructor said Senator Ted Kennedy and his friends were shipping poor people into distant neighborhoods. Those neighborhoods were smart and realized it was cheaper to buy bus tickets for those poor people and send them to Hyannisport. The governors of states where Obama is dumping Muslim immigrants should buy bus tickets and box lunches and send the Muslims to Chappaqua and to the liberal gated communities.
And the latter would be great, because I thank you for the call. All the people who are for unbridled immigration, for instance, from across our southern border, I'll never forget, there was a fellow that I used to get a telephone call from about every day when I was hosting a radio show in Delaware, and he had worked in the Justice Department for Robert Bork. And he told me one day when it came to the issue of illegal immigration, he said, all of the Democrats and the elites who are behind it, he said, all live in places where they don't have to deal with it. He said, if these people were setting up shop and living in their wealthy neighborhoods, they would be upset. But as it was mainly the poor people who had to deal with it all. So, you know, the Ted Cruz commercial, too, where they showed the lawyers racing across the southern border and running through the desert with their briefcases and their dark suits, was to point out that the jobs of the elites are not threatened by any of this. And when it comes to terrorism, you know, generally it happens on a city bus or in public transport, somewhere like that, where the rich aren't taking part in that either. You know, they don't have to worry about it. So they're the ones telling us, oh, this is a good thing. Let's pat ourselves on the back. We're wonderful. Maybe it's because of the guilt they have about how they live that they feel they have to do this. You know, with the poverty in this country and the people out of work in this country, and there's still about 94 million. We heard all the ballyhooing today about the jobs report. 255,000 jobs created in July. Better than expectations. Now the economy is on the mend. And, of course, in 6 weeks, they will come out and revise those figures down to about 125,000. And it'll be on page A17 of your newspaper. It won't be on the front page like the, oh, isn't Obama great? 255,000 jobs. Yep. Except that 94.5 million Americans are out of the workforce still. And we can't get people in government to think about them. No, let's bring in refugees and give them all the jobs. Let's bring in illegal aliens and give them all of the jobs. Say, and by the way, I want to tell you, both Consuela and the poor Syrian woman over here, they'll clean my toilet for next to nothing. Isn't that great? 9:15, Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310. KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. And if you've got objections about this, perhaps they're trying to organize ways to quiet you. I happened to come across this at LifeZet. The headline is, UN backs secret Obama takeover of police. And this is a quote from a UN document, a paragraph right at the top of this story. The Civil Rights Division of the Department of Justice has provided oversight and recommendations for improvement of police services in a number of cities with consent decrees. This is one of the most effective ways to reduce discrimination in law enforcement, and it needs to be beefed up and increased to cover as many as the 18,000-plus local law enforcement jurisdictions. That came out of a July 27th United Nations report. In other words, they want to nationalize police in America, basically have them all working under the direction of Washington, and that would mean the elimination of your locally elected sheriff. We have another caller with us. You're up next. You're on the air on News Radio 1310, KLIX, and NewsRadio1310.com.
Yeah, good morning, Bill. Yeah, the White House explanation of this $500 million thing just being a coincidence. What they're really trying to say is what Hillary said, what difference does it make? I'll take my comment off the air.
The fact of the matter is, most Americans, if they had been asked to go to a ballot box and approve this deal for the Iranians in the first place, would have said no, and overwhelmingly so. And yet, you've got to go, look, the Democrats, the majority of Americans now are opposed to abortion, and yet the Democrats are still saying, let's kill some more babies. That was a cornerstone of their convention. An overwhelming majority of Americans and almost half of all Democrats in the country say they want no public funding of abortions, and the Democrats say, let's go give your tax dollars to killing babies. Majority of Americans say they don't want cake bakers to be forced to participate in weddings against their religious beliefs. And the Democrats say, to heck with you. A majority of Americans say that they don't want grubby old 35-year-old men peeing next to their 3-year-old daughters in public restrooms or hanging out in the locker rooms with them. And yet the Democrats say, no, you got a 3-year-old. I like her. We're dealing with the enshrinement of lies, perversion, and criminality in our way of life. And these are the people who are responsible for it. 917, Bill Colley with you. The trouble is that you've got a lot of Republicans in government who are willing to go along to get along because apparently someone won't like them if they criticize having some transgendered dude come into the bathroom and molest your daughter, or to have some terrorist come into your neighborhood and start blowing it up, or to have some illegal immigrant come and take your job. Well, you know, they'll talk a good game when they see you somewhere privately, but to get them to actually take any action on this, this country, we are headed for something really, really bad. And that's not to say that, you know, we don't know who's going to come out on top of all of this, but we are headed for a crack-up because the public no longer trusts the elites. The elites don't like the public. Your public servants, as George Will says, believe that their public office is their private property. They go take your tax dollars for their own health care and tell you, well, you know, you got to live with what you have. These are people we are dealing with now who are nothing more than a criminal cabal. Got about a minute before the break, and you're up next. You're on air. All right, let's try line two. As far as you know, it's line two, right? You're up next. You're on the air on KLIX.
Yes, Bill, I'm calling back quickly. Governor Andrus of Idaho was Secretary of the Interior, I can't remember under who what president, and he backed Obama, and he lives in Idaho. And when I found out he was backing Obama, I wanted to ask him, you know, if I could somehow get a hold of him and ask him how in the hell he could justify it, because he seemed like a reasonable, grounded man. And I never could get through, but you say to yourself, when you hear somebody do this, I want to have them logically explain to me why they're doing it. And then I don't remember if he did it in 2012 or not, but to this day, I'd like him to answer, you know, what this man has done for our country that he can justify that has been good. Governor Evans, who was from Burley, where I live, he was a Democrat too, but he was in poor health, and I never was able to ask those questions to him. I'm going to hang up. Thanks.
Thank you. You know, the only other Cecil I ever knew was the guy who hung around with Beanie, you know, the seasick one. Again, they know better than everybody else, don't you know? I mean, that's it. And they're patting themselves on the back about how wonderful they are. And unfortunately, again, completely out of touch. Speaking of that, some details on the latest presidential polling coming up in just a moment. For the most part, when I vote for a candidate, I vote for a candidate on a bank of issues. Now, when I vote for president or maybe a state office, I do look to find candidates who are pro-life, and that's the overriding issue for me. And I say for state-level candidates because if it ever is decided in court again and they flip Roe v. Wade, then it will become a state's issue, and the states will have their own laws. So I vote for pro-life people in those races. But generally, when I'm looking at a candidate, I try to say, okay, here's a number of issues that concern me. And if they're right on 70, 75% of them, I'll back them. And so I back a lot of people in this community who I think are wrong on this issue of refugee resettlement. But here's the thing. We know that they don't have any control over the ultimate project. And all they can do is make some noise. What gets me is how little noise they make publicly, because here's the thing. It's 925. Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310, KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com at 66. Here's the thing. I have had a number of these people tell me off the record and off air that they are very concerned about this. And long before anything happened at Fawnbrook Apartments, they were concerned about rising crime in this community. We had a caller who referenced the fellow the other day, the big mouth, who came here in the refugee program, who stabbed an old friend and then told the judge he was being, you know, nasty in court, said, give me $100 million bail. And the judge said, well, okay, sure, you can have it. People like that who are coming here, people say, well, Bill, I mean, even white people commit crimes and Christians commit crimes. Sure, they do. Why add more, though? Why add more? And that's, so they are concerned about this, but they are publicly unwilling to speak their fears. Why? Why? I mean, I'm willing to do it, and I do it every day. And, you know, it could cost me. It has cost me before when it comes to this line of work. But you know what? You have to be true to this stuff. And when so many of them were campaigning last year, and you'd bring the subject up, and you'd get, well, you know, when the azimuth is connected to the lindenmuth and the vermouth, and when the fromisht fromisht, and it, no, I want an answer, and so does the public. 9:26 now. Speaking of some folks in this community, not all people in this community are people we have to be worried about. Some of them are really stand-up human beings, including Dr. Eric F. Jones, who uses a holistic, systemic approach to wellness. And he's been doing this since 1993. He has master's and doctoral degrees in marriage and family therapy. Gosh, we need those now. Dr. Eric F. Jones uses methods of alternative healing such as naturopathy, medicinal herbs, nutrition, sound waves, intellectual cognitive recognition, self-regulation, and napathy to help remedy and manage mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual challenges. He's accepting new patients, and he's got evening and weekend appointments available. That would be Saturday. Please contact him by calling 731-7178. He's also available on Facebook. His group page is Eric F. Jones, PhD, Mental Health and Wellness Therapist. 736-0300, the number to reach our program today, 736-0300. And we're taking calls, on a number of different issues today. But primarily, most of the callers have been referencing, many of them attended the remarks last night. I said the crowd was maybe 700. A caller said it might have been larger. And the newspaper simply divided that by several multiples and called it 200. you know what? 2 plus 2 is 5. 2 plus 2 is 5. 2 plus 2 is 5. Somebody said they're using Common Core math over there now. I have a story related to this. Kazir Khan, a media darling and, of course, a friend of the Clinton crime family, says that Donald Trump is having many slip-ups now publicly because Allah is making him do it. Kazir being a good American, of course. As we told you the other day, his buddies in mainstream media, the fellow travelers, are not telling you that 33 years ago he wrote a scholarly paper where he insisted Sharia is the best form of law ever devised, and we could use it here. But hey, you know, pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. Got about a minute before the break. Bill Colley with you on Top Story on News Radio 1310, KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. Can I squeeze this in? No, I'm going to have to do it in the next segment. It's a little too long. Larry Sabato, appearing last night on Fox News, was saying, and he's not alone, and Barry Goldwater was running for president 52 years ago. In August, he was 36 points down in polls to Lyndon Johnson. That was insurmountable. On the other hand, throughout American history, many times a candidate for president has been down by 10 points and come back and won the election. And generally, that was after conventions ended in late August or early September. We have a lot of time, being in early August. We have a great deal of time still before we actually get to election day. So all of these people who are writing Trump off, and of course, it benefits media to say he's done, it's over with, go home, don't vote if you're a Trump guy because your candidate's going to lose. That way, if you follow their instructions, he certainly will lose. But when Khan sits here and says that, you know, Allah is making him screw up, well, what happens? What would happen if, let's say, a Christian pastor came along and said, God is punishing someone? You'd hear the media go, God doesn't go around doing that to people publicly. No, never. In fact, Franklin Graham said that Joe Biden performing a same-sex wedding at his vice president's residency, the Naval Observatory, the other day, clearly is sinful. And God will take note of that when he judges this country. And media is already mocking him. But if Kazir Khan references media's pal Allah, by gosh, he must be right. Got more on this coming up in just a couple of minutes. Bill Colley with you on Top Story on KLIX. Pollster Frank Luntz says that Trump is cratering. Now, that's because of the big swing. One poll actually shows Trump now down nationally 15 percentage points, although that seems to be the outlier. Most of them show 9 or 10 points, somewhere in that range. Luntz made an appearance on Fox News Channel yesterday, though, and he's echoing what a great many people in media are saying. It's still not over, folks. There's a long ways to go.
He has to turn around his campaign by changing the focus, changing the tone, and remember that if this is a campaign about Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump wins. But if it's a campaign about Donald Trump, then Hillary Clinton wins.
So here's the thing. He's got to get the focus away from Khazir Khan and Megyn Kelly and Ted Cruz, because that's all past now. And he's got to focus on the U.S. economy and Hillary Clinton. And I do believe that by the time we get to October, that there's going to be another dump of Clinton emails. Well, I said Clinton emails. The first were from the DNC, although they involved her in the fact that the DNC was clearing the field for her, which it wasn't supposed to do. Technically, the National Committee is neutral. But we'll see a dump of Clinton emails. I firmly believe it. And these things are going to be so scurrilous that it will sink her campaign, that the American people are going to look at this and they're going to say to themselves, you know what? This is one dangerous broad. And with that, the numbers will swing back momentously in Donald Trump's direction. But he has to remain, what's the old line? Pat Buchanan used it today, saying he's got to keep his eyes on the prize. That was the line from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Well, he needs to do that. It's Hillary Clinton, and it's the economy, stupid. I also borrowed that, too. That comes from James Carville. Meanwhile, speaking of his treatment of this Khazir Khan and Mrs. Khan about their son being, of course, he never criticized the son, and that's the part that most people apparently aren't sure of. This is a woman named Karen Vaughn. She's also a Gold Star mother, and she angered somebody at CNN yesterday when she was asked about, well, aren't you offended by what Donald Trump had to say? And she said, well, let me tell you, he's not the only person who has been offensive to Gold Star families.
You know, and just to, yes, you heard that. And just to clarify that, what I mean by that is there's just a lot more important things going on. I mean, this story has been going on for a week now. And I'm not saying that Mrs. Khan probably had a right to be offended by it, you know, but the thing is let me just tell you my perspective. Words don't mean as much to me as actions. That's just me. You know, when my son was killed, he was killed in the largest loss of life in the history of naval special warfare. And we had 30 families at Dover Air Base waiting for our sons to be returned from Afghanistan. And you know what we experienced there was, and I'm just trying to draw a contrast. I'm not trying to bring up old mm-hmm. news, but you know what we experienced there is the families unanimously asked Barack Obama to not bring any media, to not make this a media event, that he was welcome to be with us, but no media. And, you know, he showed up with cameras, and the next day, his picture, saluting the caskets of our boys, was plastered over every outlet in America, I guess. And, you know, I'm just saying, you know, if you're gonna just be outraged that one person says something that could be construed as a flippant remark without a lot of thought put behind it, you know, what about the outrage over the things people do? What about the outrage over, you know, Hillary Clinton still to date insinuating that those grieving parents who say she said one thing must be mistaken? You know, it's just actions mean a lot more to me than words. That's just kind of the angle I come from on it.
I remember when that happened. They were Navy SEALs and they were in Afghanistan, and it's believed that somebody released details on where they were going to be, and the Taliban shot them down and 30 of them were killed. And she's saying President Obama couldn't wait to use that as a photo op, even after he was told by the families, we don't want a photo op. We don't want this publicized for the benefit of you. And President Obama said, you know what? I see a great opportunity to look like I'm a serious, brooding president here. And he showed up with the cameras, even though he'd been told no cameras. Now, media at the time didn't care about that. It was because it's their guy, you know? Oh, yeah, well, he's the smartest human being in the history of the planet, you know? You can't go around criticizing him. And if you do, you're a racist. Bill Colley with you this morning on Top Story on News Radio 1310. KLIX and NewsRadio1310.com. It's 66. We're coming up on 20 minutes away from 10 o'clock. Before we get to the break, and then we'll have some closing thoughts on all of this as well. I do want to remind you, if you're having difficulty hearing our program, you need to see Dr. Christine Pickup, a doctor of audiology at Mount Harrison Audiology in Rupert. She is the only locally owned and operated hearing screening center now in southern Idaho. And she reminds you, with advances in healthcare, people live longer, healthier lives. However, cognitive decline continues to be a major concern, and people with hearing loss have a much greater risk of developing cognitive decline, which can lead to dementia. The greater the loss, the greater the risk. And keeping your hearing healthy is an important part of your overall wellness. Knowing your hearing status and doing something about it can lead to a better, healthier life as you age. And she reminds you, now is the time to schedule a hearing evaluation. You can call Mount Harrison Audiology for an appointment today. Telephone number 312-0957, and of course online at mountharrisonaudiology.com.